Well, it's a little bit early, but I'm going to go ahead and apply some underglaze. And I'm using Duncan cover coat right now. I think supplied with your glaze kit, you have Mako. There's all different kinds of underglazes, different colors produced by different companies. You know, the ones that I got you are inexpensive, but work very well, and it's going to give you a sample of various colors that you can try. So I say just, you know, jump in and have fun with it. Now you need something to apply the underglaze with. So I've got some brushes here, and I'll just talk about real quick. It's good to have several brushes. I've got, you know, tons of brushes, all kinds of brushes here, but they're not all great for applying underglaze. For applying underglaze, you want a soft brush, so try to select some brushes that work well for you. Underglaze brushes going to be the same as your glaze brushes, so you don't need to buy different sets. And you can buy sets of brushes. The trouble with sets is you don't always get the brush that you want. This is a mop brush. It's called the mop brush because it's got a big mop head, and it'll hold a lot of glaze material. It's soft, and this is a number 10 Duncan. It's probably what, 3/4 inch to an inch, and this will hold a lot of material. This is what you want for applying underglaze or glaze to large surface areas. This is especially good for applying the overglaze. After you do your underglaze, we'll fire the piece, and then you'll put an overglaze clear over the top, and that will bring out all of the color potential in the glaze. Other types of brushes, you have your square tips. Hope you can see those. Kind of a dragger brush for giving you nice lines. I use an awful lot the angle shader. This is a very small example of the angle shader. See if I can get it on camera here, and here, or here, wherever the camera might be. And this will give you really good crisp line. So just remember that you want a soft brush. If you buy kits, you're probably going to get some coarse brushes as well. These are going to leave a lot of texture, and that may be what you're after. It may be good. So just be conscious of how the glaze applies. This is a fan brush, so this is good for fanning out glaze, blending underglazes. With underglaze, you can mix those colors together. One glaze, they are opaque, so one glaze will cover another. Consider that when you're layering glazes or overlapping or trying to cut in a good line. You can use stencils, you can use sponges for applying glaze and getting texture. Underglaze is great because it does allow you to have some texture. Underglaze is like applying slip that's colored. So you can do all kinds of textural things with underglaze. Squeeze bottles with syringe tips are great. Anyway, the underglaze itself, very simple to apply. Just mix it well. Make sure you shake the glaze up well, underglaze. And then select your brush. again. I'm covering this entire interior edge with a white glaze, so I'll have a really nice base to work with. I'm just checking to make sure I got all of the dust out of this. If you recall, I sanded this first, and then compressed. But I can feel a little bit of texture. So when I apply the underglaze, that will go away. And when I say texture, just like a little bit of grit, like the sand or the surface on the surface. But nothing to be. I like to actually wet my brushes with water first. I don't have clean water nearby. So I'm just going to go ahead and go in and try to saturate the brush. So I'm working the underglaze into the bristles here. And if I wanted, I could just pour some in there because it's on this banding wheel. And if I pour it in, I can just spread it out. But I'm going to go ahead and just try to get a first initial coat down. And this will show you where the imperfections are in your piece, because the glaze will typically skip over you can see how there's some areas it's hitting and areas it's missing. Those areas it's missing are slightly recessed. But you want to make sure you get the glaze in, or the underglaze, I keep calling it glaze, in there. Into everything. Now, a mop brush is not a really great brush for cutting in a nice sharp edge. I kind of like the way it's skipping across that texture, so I'll just let that happen. And I might even go over the rim. Now I'm just trying to lay on a little bit thicker. So it's a real light touch. I rotated my brush and then just trying to smooth that out. I'll allow that to dry and it won't take long, and then I can apply another coat. It usually says to apply 2 to 3 coats. Usually 2 coats is plenty. It depends on how wet your work is. What I mean by wet is how damp your greenware is. Obviously, the damper it is, the longer it's going to take the underglaze to dry. If it's bone dry, it'll dry really pretty quickly. I'm going to just allow this to skip over the top of this rim and accentuate that texture. It's kind of a nice look. So you don't want to load up too heavy with your underglaze, or otherwise you'll fill in all of that. You can apply underglaze to bisqueware, but it limits what you can do with your piece. At this point, because this is still greenware, I can actually do like sgraffito type technique, which would mean I could go in there and carve through the underglaze to expose the clay underneath, which is a contrasting color, to give myself design. You can't really do that with once the piece has been bisqueware. If I do too much heat, yeah, I run the potential of cracking it, or causing the underglaze itself to crackle and pull away. So don't want to overdo that. It's dry enough now. I can still see a little bit of sheen in some of the recessed areas that filled in a little bit more glaze. But it's dry enough now that I can go ahead and add another coat, which is what I'll do. I'm going to load up my brush pretty heavy right now, see? And very light pressure, because I'm just trying to lay the underglaze on there. I want a thick, rather thick coat, because I don't want to put another coat on. So I want it done in two shots. And then maybe kind of a finished skim coat to get the lines out. That looks pretty good. Oh, I like that. I have a good coat of glaze, or underglaze. I have to correct myself every time I say that. And now I'm just going to go over the top here to kind of add to that little texture enhancement. Bring out that. Yeah, I'm liking that a lot. If I can get on the side here. So having done that, I'm looking at the exterior, and now it's starting to kind of play itself out. I'm thinking, well, I'll go back in and hit these to highlight so that it reflects what's going on the rim. I would have to use a much smaller brush to get to that little detail right here. I'm using my finger here to press on this as I drag across to try to get all of the underglaze out. Don't allow this stuff to build up on the rim. Get it back into the underglaze and allow that to merge. It's a good idea to have a wet sponge with clean water. I just found some clean water. So I'm going to spray clean water on this rag here. Wipe the edge of this down so it's clean. And I can do the same in here. It's really important to get your lids on the jars correctly. You store them away and they're like this, they're going to dry out on you. You don't want that. Make sure they're on there. Go back and forth until it screws down nicely, and don't crank it down super tight, just snug is good. Okay, just a snug fit. Because the next time you go to open it, it will be harder. There are glycerins in here that will act like glue. If that happens and you can't get the lid off, so run a little bit of water along there, along the rim, turn it upside down, tap the lid, and then you should be able to crack it open pretty easily at that point. I'll get it. It'll look better when I'm done with it, satisfied. Back with paint. I wanted it to be quick and easy. Not so. But you get the idea. It has a little bit more relationship to the rim. And that's as very simple. Once you've completed underglazing your piece, you can set it on the shelf to be bisque fired, and I will come in and load the work into the bisque kiln, fire it up, and let you know when you're able to pick it up. Once you picked it up, you can then apply your glaze coat. Without getting it everywhere else. Clean up some areas that wanted to fill in, and we'll pretty much call that done. Overkill there. Okay, I'm getting messy, but that's what I do out here in the studio. So I'll go clean up, and we'll see you again on another day. Take care.